Good morning.
Good morning.
And welcome to this to the Divine Metaphysical Research. This is a school, and it is not a church, and neither are we affiliated with any church or religious organization. This school is a nonprofit, non-denominational, religious, and scientific research organization dedicated to proving the existence of Yahweh, our Elohim, and the operation of the eternal pattern, purpose, and plan operating throughout eternity unto this present day. Now, this school is a result of a divine vision and revelation given to our founder, Dr. Henry Clifford Kenley, in the state of Ohio in the year 1931, and we're incorporated in the state of California in the year 1958. Since that time, we have established branch schools throughout the United States, Canada, and some other foreign countries. The Interior Branch School was established in May of 1988. Now, in this school, we use and teach by the true and original names and titles of the Father, the Word of Son, and the Holy Spirit, which are contained in the original Hebrew text. The true name for the Heavenly Father is Yahweh. It has been improperly substituted by Lord. The true title for the Word or Son is Elohim. It has also been improperly substituted by God. And the true name for the Holy Spirit manifested in or out of a physical body is Yahshua. It has been erroneously substituted by Jesus Christ. Now, Lord and God, they are titles and not names. The Apostle Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, tells us in 1 Corinthians 8:5, that there are Lord's many and God's many. But we now know that each Lord must have a name, and each God must have a name also. Elohim is a title, but unlike Lord and God, Elohim is a divine title. This means that Elohim is a title that our Creator chose for Himself. Jesus is a name, but Jesus is an erroneous name. A minor investigation on your part into a good dictionary or encyclopedia would prove that the Hebrew language, the Greek language, nor the Latin language have any characters or letters in their alphabet that would produce a sound that is made by this letter J. Neither was there a letter J in the English language until some 1400 years after the death of the Messiah. Therefore, such names as Jesus and Jehovah are impossible renderings for the true and original name of our Heavenly Father and His Son. Christ is a title just like Lord and God. Yahweh is pure spirit, and in this state is incomprehensible, inscrutable, and indiscernible. He is the ultimate source, substance, limits, and bounds of everything. We have Yahweh on this chart symbolized in his pure spirit state as a cloud. Yahweh is not a cloud. He merely chose a cloud to symbolize himself because a cloud had no descriptive or shape and form. Now, we draw this cloud all around the edges of this chart to show you that everything on this chart is within the cloud. In like manner, everything in the universe abides within the pure spirit state of Yahweh. Now, Yahweh, knowing that man could not perceive of him in this pure spirit state, took on shape and took on form right within himself as Elohim. This is the Word or Son, a super incorporeal being, that is, having the shape and form of a man, but without flesh and blood. Now, this shape and form can only be seen in a divine vision and understood in a divine revelation. Later on, the self-same spirit manifests himself in a physical body and walked the earth plane as Yahshua the Messiah. The world calls him Jesus Christ. Now, there's only one name given us salvation, and we all must know this name. So the simple yet intelligent question we should ask ourselves is, what was the name of the Savior during the time he walked the earth plane? A further understanding of this name and title could be had by reading the preface of the Holy Name Bible. Also in the school, we teach, or we prove that everything in the universe operates according to the structure and function of the threefold tabernacle pattern, and absolutely nothing escapes the pattern. Now the 10 primary constitutional objectives or aims of this tour are as follows. Number one is to help you find and know Yahweh, our Elohim, as He really is and actually exists. Two is to form a nucleus of universal brotherhood of humanity in Yahshua the Messiah, without distinction of race, nationality, creed, sex, caste, or color. Third is to investigate the unexplained spirit law, which we'll call law of nature, and the powers latent in man. Fourth is to encourage and promote the study of the scriptures, comparative religions, psychology, philosophy, modern, practical, and occult science. Fifth is to extirpate current superstitions, skepticism, and ignorance. Sixth is to learn, know, and understand the operation of Yahweh's eternal purpose through the dispensation and ages. Seventh is to discern and avoid being deceived by Lucifer, the serpent, the dragon, or Satan and his demons, operating the mystery of iniquity on earth through the dispensation of time. And eighth is to earnestly contend for the common salvation of faith that was once delivered unto the sons or children of Yahweh. And ninth is to make known that Yahweh, from the beginning ordained, there is no other name given among men whereby man must be saved, save in the name of Yahshua the Messiah. And tenth is to inherit eternal life now in the kingdom of Yahshua the Messiah with the hope of immortal glorification in the newer state. Our mantra is peace, our slogan, speak the truth. This morning we have prayer by Dr. Irene Ramirez. Our scripture lesson is James, the fourth chapter, and our scripture reader will be Dr. Eunice Reiser. And we have a selection of music after the prayer.
Good morning, class.
Good morning.
So we'd like to thank Yahweh again for gathering us here today so we could learn about Him through His Son, Yahshua Messiah. And we ask Him for knowledge and wisdom and understanding, so we can keep on learning of Him, because that's all we need, really, is just to learn about Him. We ask this in Your Son's name, Yahshua Messiah, let's all say, Hallelujah.
Thank you.
Good morning, class.
Good morning.
The scripture lesson this morning will be taken from James, the fourth chapter, and I'll be reading from the Holy Name Bible containing the Holy Name version of the Old and New Testament, critically compared with ancient authorities and various manuscripts, revised by the late A.B. Trainum, Scripture Research Association Incorporated. James, the fourth chapter, page 305. From whence come wars and fighting among you? Come they not hence, even of your lust that war in your members? Ye lust and have not. Ye kill and desire to have and cannot obtain. Ye fight and war, yet ye have not, because ye ask not. Ye ask and receive not, because ye ask amiss, that ye may consume it upon your lust. Ye adulterers and adulteress, know ye not that the friendship of the world is enmity with Yahweh? Whosoever therefore will be a friend of the world is the enemy of Yahweh. Do ye think that the scripture teacheth in vain? The spirit that dwelleth in us lusteth to envy? But he giveth more grace, wherefore it is said, Yahweh resisteth the proud, but giveth grace unto the humble. Submit yourselves, therefore, to Yahweh. Resist the adversary, and he will flee from you. Draw nigh to Yahweh, and he will draw nigh to you. Cleanse your hands, ye sinners, and purify your hearts, ye double-minded. Be afflicted and mourn and weep. Let your laughter be turned to mourning and your joy to heaviness. Humble yourselves in the sight of Yahweh, and he shall lift you up. Speak not evil one of another, brethren. He that speaketh evil of his brother and judgeth his brother speaketh evil of the law and the judgeth the law. But if thou judge the law, thou art not a doer of the law, but a judge. There is one lawgiver who is able to save and to destroy. Who art thou that judgeth another? Go to now, ye that say, today or tomorrow we will go into such a city and continue there a year and buy and sell and get gain. Whereas ye know not what shall be on the morrow. For what is your life? It is even a vapor that appeareth for a little time and then vanishes away. For that ye ought to say, if Yahweh is willing and we shall live, we will do this or that. But now ye rejoice in your boasting, all such rejoicing is evil. Therefore to him that knoweth to do good and doeth it not, to him it is sin. I read the fourth chapter of James. Let us all say hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Okay, thank you. And usually it's our winter series of lectures, but I don't know who's supposed to be up. But without further ado, I'll call the Dean of the Interior by School, Dr. Joe Williams.
Good evening. Good morning, class.
Good morning.
Good morning.
It's always a pleasure and honor to stand before the assembly of Yahweh, or Yahshua Messiah, as testifier of some of the things that he's allowed me to see and understand about this great teaching. I figure today I'll just talk about eternal life. What is eternal life, and how do you achieve it? And I think once we get a handle on what eternal life is, what it might do, it might inspire us to make an earnest effort to come to class, be on time, and try to learn as much as you can, because we all have a short time that's on this earth plane, and nobody knows the time or the hour when we're going to take off the flesh.
Right.
Now, this is the definition of eternal life. Pick up John 17:3. Now, before we read that, the purpose of coming here is to help you find and know Yahweh, our Elohim, as he really is and actually exists. And the founder of the school, who had the divine vision revelation direct from Yahweh himself, said, I had divine vision revelation. Don't believe it because I said it, but make me prove it to your satisfaction. But what we do to try to get across to the audience, we try to want you to see and understand that we use tools that Yahweh has given us to come to a profound understanding of Yahweh's divine purpose and his pattern and his plan. Now, when I say profound, I'm talking about having a working knowledge of the purpose and plan of Yahweh from start to finish. Now, the tools that we use is this. We have a creation. You see, I'm talking about the sun, moon, and stars, and all things therein to use as a witness to understand something about Yahweh and his divine purpose. Secondly, he's given us a pattern. I'm talking about the tabernacle pattern, which has a most holy place, a holy place, and a court roundabout. Three compartments and nine furnishings. Three furnishings in each compartment, okay? That is also we're going to use as a tool. Thirdly, he's given us the law and the prophets. The law is the first five books of your Bible. That is Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy, which was written by the man Moses. And then the prophets, okay? That's the next 34 books. That is from Joshua down to Malachi. See, and at the time that the Messiah was walking around on the Palestine Judean hill, the only thing they had at that particular time was the law and the prophet, what people call the Old Testament or the Old Covenant. But we're going to look at the Old Covenant to show you how Yahshua is coming up, is being manifested in the scriptures and coming along and fulfilling those scriptures when he's manifested on the earth plane in the 4,000 year or in the fourth millennium. But finally, the witness that we're going to use is your physical body, and that your physical body lines up with this tabernacle, you see, and this tabernacle having a most holy place, a holy place, and a court roundabout, lines up to your head region, your chest region, and your abdominal region, whereby you function as one unit, just like you have one Yahweh, you see, in two manifestations. So we're going to use the pattern, we're going to use the law of the prophets, we're going to also use the creation and all things therein as a witness to get you to see something about Yahweh, the divine purpose, and what eternal life is all about. But we're going to also utilize your physical body to use as a witness. Everybody with me so far?
Yes.
Now, this is what the definition is of, this is what the definition of eternal life is. Read, please.
John 17:3.
Uh-huh.
And this is life eternal.
Uh-huh.
That they might know that thou only art the true El, and Yahshua Messiah whom thou hast sent.
Now, this is life eternal. This is what eternal life is. That thou, read.
Thou only art the true
Elohim. That thou only, Elohim, art the true Elohim. You see, who is Elohim? Elohim is Yahweh, who is spirit, being made up of the divine attributes of intelligence, wisdom and knowledge, beauty, love, justice, foundation, power, and strength. That's what Yahweh is. You cannot see intelligence with your natural physical eyes. You cannot say wisdom. You can't see wisdom or knowledge or love or beauty or justice or foundation or power or strength or joy or hope or peace or mercy. Those are also attributes. These are just nine principal attributes that Yahweh chose to carry out his divine purpose. But there is a multiplicity of attributes that is laid down in these attributes here. We can take love and put it with mercy, we got justice. Do you understand what I'm talking about? So that's just a little bit to show you what we're talking about. But this is Yahweh's attribute of makeup. Now keep this in mind. I'm going to take plate one or two when you get a chance and just put it over there. Yeah, these attributes are very important for you to understand. Because just as Yahweh is spirit, and this is his divine makeup, it is also your divine makeup. If Yahweh is spirit, and he is, then his byproduct has to be that of himself. He is incorporeal, and then he is corporeal. In other words, he is in a spirit embodiment. He's also in a physical manifestation, you see, of the one spirit. Now keep this in mind. Yahweh is not just intelligence. He is the source of intelligence. He is the source of wisdom, the source of knowledge, beauty, love, justice, foundation, power, and strength. He is the origin and the essence of everything that you see. But when Yahweh is in his pure spirit state, or in his abstract state, or what we call his ontological state of perfection, if you will, this is him in his ideal, in his ideal be state, and in his state of rest. Keep this in mind when you're looking at spirit. There is nothing that precedes or that is pre-existence of spirit. You cannot get outside of spirit to look back on it, just like you can't get outside of yourself to look back on yourself.
Right.
But everything in the universe abides within the pure spirit state. And Yahweh himself, he abides within the realm of eternity. What is eternity? See, look. Eternity has no beginning and it has no ending. Yahweh has no beginning and he has no ending. But in reality, Yahweh had to create eternity to abide in. And we're trying to get you into the realm of eternity. And listen, when you come into the realm of eternity, you see, there is a consciousness and an awareness of the spirit of the living Elohim in you. And you'll understand that this spirit that we're talking about, it talks to you. It walks with you. It is every place. In other words, it is omnipresent. You can't get outside of it because it is all in all. You see? So therefore, we take you back to the beginning or to the origin, you see, of everything. Because Yahweh, just the name itself, what it means is this. He who causes to exist. If it exists, it exists by the will of Yahweh. We got the sun, moon, and stars. That exists by the will of Yahweh. The man himself, he exists by the will of Yahweh. You understand? So everything that is being created, or everything that you see, or everything that is known, unknown, visible, invisible, animate, inanimate, you see, has its origin, or its start place, or its beginning with Yahweh. And Yahweh, who is spirit, is both masculine and feminine within himself. What does that mean? That means Yahweh himself is the parent substance. It is him who is capable and equipped within himself to give birth to a physical or a material creation. It is him who is capable of giving birth to his son. So when Yahweh, who purposed and declared within himself what shall be, when he purposed the purpose, he purposed it with you in mind. What are you talking about? He knew that you would not understand him in his abstract state, in his pure spirit state. Because Yahweh, in this state, keep this in mind, this is pure creativity. This is infinite possibilities and pure potentiality that is in the abstract state. And each one of these attributes are beyond the possibility of death. It's important that you understand what spirit is. Because if you can't understand what spirit is, you're not going to understand what anything else is. Keep this in mind. Yahweh in this day, he is the ultimate source, the immaculate substance. You see, the limits, the bounds, the origin, and the essence of all things. And everything that you see, it proceeds and comes forth from the source or from spirit or pure spirit. You see, that's what you need to understand. And as he's coming from pure spirit, it is Yahweh himself who's taking on shape and form. It is not Yahweh and his son. It is Yahweh as the son. It is Yahweh transformed or transmuted into the threefold, I'll say it like this, into the spirit embodiment as Elohim, who is the archetype, original pattern of the universe. What do you mean? Archetype just simply means original. But since you can't see him in this state condition, you see, he moved from the abstract state into the incorporeal state. You see, a spirit embodiment. As it was said, he is a super incorporeal anthropomorphic being. That's what he is. That simply means a man in shape and in form without flesh, bone, or blood. That's all it means. You see, simple little thing. We had to say all that, say that, which is in shape and form, right? But it's a super incorporeal or anthropomorphic being, meaning that, like I said, without shape and without form. This is what we call the intermediate state. We talk about transmutation. Transmutation means this: abstract, intermediate, and concrete. Pure spirit, you see, incorporeal, you see, and concrete or corporeal. Or Yahweh being spirit in two manifestations: an incorporeal state condition and a corporeal state condition. Invisible, visible. Visible, invisible. You see, that's what that is. Transmutation. Abstract, intermediate, concrete, or concrete. So, we talk about eternal life. What is eternal life? Now, Yahweh, who is spirit, when he takes on shape and form, that is him. I didn't mean to do that. That is him coming down out of his high and lofty state into a state whereby you can communicate and you can talk to him. And what he does, he just appears within the cloud. In other words, I'll just do it this way. We got the cloud right here. And what he does, he just appears within the cloud without shape and form. And that is him standing on the earth, appearing in your consciousness. Mm-hmm. Now, to prove that, you have an inner man, you have an outer man. So that should tell you, you are a reflection of your creator, and that you have an inner man and you have an outer man. Mm-hmm. But they walk simultaneously, or they walk, or they function in harmony. They work together. That's what you need to see. Talking about eternal life. Now read that again. 17:3. This is the definition of John 17:3, the definition of eternal life. Let's read.
And this is life eternal.
Read.
That they might know that thou only art the true El, and Yahshua Messiah, whom thou hast sent.
Now, this is the key word. Read that one more time.
And this is life eternal.
Uh-huh.
That they might know that thou only art the true El.
That they may know. Mm-hmm. You might know that they, that thou, Father, you are the only true Elohim.
Right.
Now, there's a lot of, how can I say it, pseudo Elohims, or phony gods, false gods, but he's the only true Elohim. There's a bunch of idols that folks want to bow down to, and this is what we do. You see this can here? We said we're going to make this an idol. Next thing you know, we buy it. They'll go to the store, buy one. Now we got candles all around it, incense all around it, and we start praying to it. It's just a can. You just bought it at the local thrift shop.
Right.
You follow what I'm saying? But this is what we do. Or you go to the Catholic Church. You know how they do. They get this force of water, Arrowhead water, Palomar water. You know, you get my point. They pour it in a little container with nice gold. They pray over and say some words over it, and instead of being water, now it's holy water.
Right.
And what they do, they take the holy water, and you know how we are. We all like this here, you know, and they put their tongue out, you know, or whatever they do, and they sprinkle you, right? They sprinkle you, and all of a sudden, the kid is holy now. He's the same, be nice, he's the same bad kid 20 years later than he was when he was a year old. You get the point? And you thinking you done baptized him or did something. You haven't done nothing. You see, but play a game with yourself. That's the illusion. But my point is this. We're trying to get you to understand eternal life. But it's to know. Now that word means a couple of things. It means also to have a knowledge and an understanding. But this is also what know means. Go to Genesis, the 4th chapter. Start the first verse. Please.
What happened to that stick?
Ground. Ground. On the ground.
Oh, okay. Read.
Genesis, I want you to understand what the word know. It does not mean having knowledge.
Right.
Genesis 4 and 1. What we're going to read about is Adam. Oh, man, there's so much. Let's do it this way. Elohim, whom the world calls God, gave birth to Adam. Then Adam gave birth to Cain. Let me put that down here. Cain, who set up that unrighteous lineage, and he also had Abel, who Cain, in turn, he killed his brother Abel, which maybe we'll talk about. And then he had another son, his name was Seth. And Seth means in place of, in that he died, he had him in place of Abel, all right? Now, we're gonna go back and look at the birth and the origin of Cain and Abel, talking about eternal life and trying to get an understanding of this word, know. Because eternal life is to know that thou art the true Elohim, all right? And I want you to also see this. Adam's daddy was Elohim.
Right.
You got to see that. And I'm going to draw that out and prove it by the scriptures in just a minute. Let's read, please.
And the man knew Eve.
And the man knew Eve.
His wife.
Now, how you going to know somebody? He knew him. Mean that there was an intimate relationship with her. You see? Read.
And she conceived and bare Cain.
So he knew her. You see? Or there was copulation to take place, and she gave birth to a son. That's how he knew her, by having an intimate relationship with Eve. Read, please.
And said, I have gotten a man, even Yahweh.
Read.
And she again bare his brother Abel.
Read.
And Abel was a herder of sheep.
Uh-huh.
But Cain was a tiller of the ground.
Now jump down to 24. 4:24. I think it's 24. Read.
If Cain shall be
avenged. Go to 25 then.
Okay. And Adam knew his wife.
And Adam knew his wife who?
Again.
Again. Read.
And she bare a son.
So in other words, knowing someone in this respect is giving birth to, having an intimate relationship. What we're trying to get you to see, you too have to have an intimate relationship with your Creator.
Right.
Knowing Him as He really is and as He actually exists. Otherwise, you don't know him. If you just go to anybody you want to be with, I'm talking about on a physical, natural basis, where you want to have a romantic relationship with, or whatever, or a friend, you got to get to know them, right? Mm-hmm. You see, you don't want to just talk about surface stuff. I'm talking about how's the job. You see, talking about the basketball game. You want to know something about them, about their essence. You want to understand their attribute of makeup. You want to know what makes them happy, what makes them sad, what makes them tick.
Right.
You see, what they like, their likes, their dislikes. Mm-hmm. You see, their attitude, their disposition. You want to understand their character and their nature. And in doing that, you got to have some conversation with some depth.
Right.
Not just talking about how your car runs. You see, look at those wheels. You ain't talking about nothing. You see, but an intimate relationship, I know him. So when somebody vouched for you, they say, listen, he's my friend. I know him for these reasons. This is not his nature. This is not his character.
Right.
You see, because you have an intimate relationship, because you know the person, because you look into the depths of their soul, and you had a connection there. And that's how you're able to express something about that person. By having an intimate relationship to make the statement that I know him, because you have spent the time and the energy. And in knowing somebody, sometimes, you see, you got to tell some people things you don't like. You know, sometimes they may do something you don't like. And you have to tell them because you love them, right? And sometimes you hurt their feelings, but they need to know.
Right.
That's everybody, right? Otherwise, you don't really love them. You're just acting like you do.
Right.
I think I'm through with that. Now go to Luke 3:38. I just want to let you see how that Elohim is the father of Adam in this respect. Yahweh, who is pure spirit, took on shape and form as Elohim, or he incarnated as Elohim. Y'all seen that movie, Avatar? You seen that movie?
Yeah.
Well, see, this shape and form is an avatar. You see?
Okay.
An avatar is a representation of you in a different shape or form. That's what the movie's, right? You have your same personality. You're still the same person. But your structure looks different, right? That's what the movie showed. You see, and you're bringing your nature and your character in that movie to a different culture. So I'm letting you try to get you to see these attributes is Yahweh's divine makeup. And then in order for him to come down out of this pure spirit state, out of the abstract state, into a state where he can be seen within your consciousness, this is him incarnated, or this is his avatar, or this is his representation. You see, as a spirit embodiment of a man, so you can have a conversation with him. That's what we're talking about. But it's not another, it's the same one, but he's clothed in a veil. You get my point?
Mm-hmm.
All right. All of us are clothed in a veil.
Right.
You see, we're talking about eternal life. But in talking about eternal life, you have to understand your origin. Because to have eternal life, you have to know. Read, please. Go back and pick up the thought again. You got 3:38, Luke 3:38?
Right. 3:38. Luke 3:38. Which was the son of Enoch,
read.
Which was the son of Seth, which was the son of Adam, which was the son of Elohim.
Now, Adam was the son of Elohim. Read it again.
Which was the son of Enoch.
Read.
Which was the son of Seth.
Read.
Which was the son of Adam.
Read.
Which was the son of Elohim.
So Adam was the son of Elohim. He gave birth to him. In that, you see, Yahweh, taking on shape and form, Moses witnessed how he assimilated creation by pattern. The pattern being the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit in an abstract state. And then he moved or come from behind the veil of inscrutability and incomprehensibility, you see, manifesting himself as the Son of Yahweh, you see, or Yahweh in his creative state, or Yahweh in his I will be state, or he's manifesting as an execution of the purpose. Because when Yahweh Elohim, or when Yahweh moved from the abstract into the incorporeal, that is him setting the purpose in motion. That is an execution of the purpose, and that is him in his creative or in his I will be state, which is illustrated right here on this chart here. With these attributes of wisdom and knowledge and intelligence being the crown, or what the founder says as the supreme crown, being flanked or giving birth to beauty, love and justice, foundation, power, and strength, and couch within the kingdom. Therefore, you should be able to see that Yahweh Elohim is the kingdom of kingdoms. He is the king of kings. He is the mystery of mystery. He is the will. He is the will of wills. He is the soul of soul, the tree of trees, the men of men. In other words, he's the whole brass band all by himself.
That's right.
Right there. He don't need me. He don't need you.
That's right.
To be who he is. He will be what he will to be. Therefore, he manifests as a creation or as the universe, talking about the angelic and the physical, to get you to see something about your origin or your state and your condition, if you will. We're talking about eternal life. That's what we're talking about. So, eternal life is to know. So now we know that Adam, Elohim, gave birth is the father of Adam. I just want you to see that. And it was Yahweh. Let me say this about Adam. This is the first and only created man that Yahweh ever made. There is no other. And listen, that body that he created, it was fitted just for him. Guess what? That body you're wearing, it is fitted just for you. You are the first and the last in that body. Nobody else gonna get up in there. We'll be nice though. You see, but nobody but you. Everybody body you wear is fitted just for you, and like it or not, it is fitted for destruction. You see, I mean, you're going to get so old, or you ain't going to want it no more.
Yeah.
You get my point?
Yeah.
This going to hurt, that going to hurt. You're going to look like, you be, look at yourself. You're like, oh, I got to get out of here. Take this thing off at some point in time. You see, you get the point.
Yeah.
So now, react it. We're going to go back over to John 17:3, where we read, talking about eternal life.
Mm-hmm. And this is life eternal.
Read.
That they might know that thou only art the true El.
Read.
And Yahshua Messiah.
And Yahshua Messiah.
Whom thou hast sent.
Now, so you gotta know who the true Elohim is. You gotta also know who the Messiah is. Let's hit on him, but I also need you to pick up John 38 chapter. Okay? But before we get John, I want you to pick up John's 5:36 first. You gotta know that thou only art the true Elohim, right? And Yahshua the Messiah, whom I have sent.
John 5:36.
Back up a little bit to. Back up to 5:28. Then we'll go to 36.
John 5:28. Marvel not at this.
Read.
For the hour is come, in the which all that are in the grave shall hear his voice and live.
Now, why is he saying that? Go back to the 15th verse. See, he had just healed a man on the Sabbath day. Mm-hmm. You see? And they got mad at him because he told the man to pick up his bed and walk. Well, there's a pool called Bethesda. And at the 600th year, when it swirls, what happened? They, whoever got into the pool first, if they had an infirmity, they would be healed. But this man had been here for 38 years. And when the Messiah passed by, he saw this man here who had been here for 38 years with this infirmity. Who going to help him get to the pool? So when he said, pick up your bed and walk. And the guy picked up his bed, he leaped and started walking. And he was so happy, he started rejoicing. Well, when he did that on the Sabbath day. And they was mad at him, you see. And they asked the man, who told you to pick up your bed and walk? Because they all knew that he was, you know, had an infirmity. He couldn't walk. Mm-hmm. You see? Had an anomaly. So now that he told him, now listen, when you do this, don't tell nobody that I did that. He made sure to tell them that. Now they mad at him, and this is what they said. Let's read.
15.
Uh-huh.
The man departed and told the Jews that it was Yahshua which had made.
So he talked anyway. All right? Let's read.
And therefore did the Jews persecute Yahshua.
So now they're looking for him.
And
read.
Sought to slay him.
Read.
Because he had done these things on the Sabbath
day. On the Sabbath day. They got mad at him for that. Read on, please.
But Yahshua answered them, my father worketh hitherto, and I work.
Read.
Therefore the Jews sought the more to kill him.
Come on.
Because they contended that he had not only had broken the Sabbath, but said also that Elohim was his father.
Amen. Go ahead.
Making himself equal with Elohim.
That's what they mad about. They mad at him because he said he was God in the body. And they didn't believe it. And I'm telling you that you too are God in the body. You are Yahweh manifested in the personality of whoever you are. You see, and ain't nobody gonna believe that until you prove it. They want you to do some magic or something like that. You know what I mean? And then they just might believe it, not understanding that everything in the universe, no, is one of another expression or manifestation of Yahweh himself, including you. That's the mystery. We all have been corrupted.
Right.
By the world, you see, and by taking on these carnal principles. Our mind is corrupt, our heart is corrupt, our soul is corrupt, and we're steeped in theory, concept, and opinion, trying to hold on to our image, you see, satisfying our flesh. And everybody likes their flesh satisfied.
Yes, sir.
I mean, come on,
yes,
we just do.
Yes,
you see, I'm talking about the inner man, and the outer man.
Yes, sir.
You just like your flesh satisfied. At the end of the day, it's the wages of death. And you're going to lead you straight to eternal life if you do not understand and take off this flesh. And I'm not talking about this. I'm talking about taking off the thoughts, the theories, the concepts, and the opinions that you embrace as reality. That's what I'm talking about. Keep reading, please.
Then answered Yahshua and said unto them,
come on.
Verily, verily, I say unto you,
uh-huh.
The Son can do nothing of himself.
Now the Son, him, not this one right here, not this physical body, this one right here.
Right.
You see, read.
but what he said the Father do.
But whatever Yahweh purposed and declared for him to do, this is what the Son doing. I'm not pointing to this physical body down here. I'm talking about this one right here. He said, when you see me, you see the Son. I mean, when you see me, you see the Father. Because me and my Father, we're one. But this body got up in that body. Read this under so much.
For what things soever he doeth, these also doeth the Son likewise.
So whatever he doeth, talking about the Son of Yahweh, or whatever Yahshua's doing, is because the Son dictated it. His inner man. Let's read, please.
For the Father loveth the Son, and showeth him all things in himself.
Now the Father loveth the shape and form. He loved Yahweh Elohim. And at the end of the day, the name of this shape and form is Yahshua. I'm sorry, it just is. It is Yahweh as Elohim, or Yahweh incarnated as Elohim, but the name of the shape and form is Yahshua. Now let me get some book on that real quick. I think it's 1 Timothy. I mean, Philippians 2 and, can't remember right now. 2 and 24 or 2 and 12? Or that's where I'm somewhere up in there. I think it's Philippians. I'm pretty sure it is. I think it's 2 and, we say gonna give him a name above every other name?
That's 2 and 10.
Is it 2 and 10? Okay.
That has the name of Yahshua, every knee,
9.
Okay. Matter of fact, you know what? Okay, let's 9. Be good about this. Let's start at 2 and 5. Okay, and then what
the heck is that? The chair. Behind the chair.
Okay. I can't see without my glasses. I had them on. I still couldn't see. Let's read, please.
Philippians 2 and 5.
Now, this is what Paul says in this age right where you sit. Let's read, please.
Let this mind be in you.
Now, go ahead and swap that up. Because mine.
Oh, yeah.
It's subject to change. Is that not right? Sign. Your mind is always subject to change.
Oh, okay.
So therefore, it ain't let this mind, it's let this spirit be in you, which was in Yahshua Messiah. Let's read, please.
Let this spirit be in you, which was also in Yahshua Messiah.
Read.
Whom being in the form of Elohim.
Read.
Did not strive to claim for himself.
In other words, it let this spirit took up residence in him. He didn't strive to do what?
To claim for himself equality.
Read.
With Yahweh.
Read.
But divested himself of his glory and took upon himself the form of a servant.
Now look, divest means to disrobe. Mm-hmm. You see, that's what divest. He divested himself. In other words, instead of him walking around like this, he manifested in a physical body. You see, and then he resurrected a quickening spirit so they could understand who he really was. He really was the shape and form of Yahweh in the body, but he was cloaked in this veil. By him being cloaked in the veil, when he disrobed, he took on an incorporeal shape and form and then ascended back to the Father and manifested and declared his name as the Son of Yahweh, which is Yahshua Messiah. Eternal life is to know that thou art the only true El and Yahshua Messiah. Read, please.
But divested himself of his glory and took upon himself this form of a servant.
Now, this is the form of the servant right here. Read. Now, the word minister means servant. That's all minister means. It means he's a servant. Mm-hmm. All right, let's read.
And was made in the likeness of men.
Read. The word, he was appearing, looking just like me and you, but he was in the likeness of sinful flesh. Had the same physical desires and everything of us, but they did not have dominion over him. Mm-hmm. You see, he was able to, I'll say, withstand or suppress his desires and overcome them. Unlike us, we just go ahead and just manifest and satisfy our flesh all because we can. That's just what we do. All right? Let's read. We don't know no better. See, he knew better. We didn't know no better. Oh, man, so much. Look, I'm sorry. As soon as we're born, our parents started lying to us. Oh, you're such a good little. Look at how cute that boy is. You see, and you, that's the first thing you see, your parents. And they start teaching you what they've embraced,
right,
which is the world. And when they embrace the world, it corrupts your soul. Because your soul is the intermediate state. In other words, it's your behavior, your attitude, your disposition. You see, it's your attributal makeup that takes on shape and form in you that makes you up. If you are a musician or come from a family musician, chances are you probably be one. You see, if you come from a family with a bunch of gangsters, you're going to end up maybe an OG, still wearing your pants down, you see, below your buttocks, closet, talking about you're an OG, you see, because your attribute makeup, you see, is dark. You get the point I'm trying to make? Because of your attitude, your nature, and your character. And what you're trying to do is to know Yahweh, you see, or Yahweh Elohim, who is the true Elohim, you see, and Yahshua the Messiah, whom thou sent. That's what eternal life is now. Not thinking what he is, but knowing what he is. Let's read, please.
And being found in the fashion as a man,
read.
He humbled himself,
read.
And became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross.
Read. Now listen, don't, just like he been obedient to death, we will too. You don't have to not want to go. You're going. You will be obedient to death.
Yeah,
if you don't just shoot yourself, y'all are gonna make sure you find your way out of this body, all right? Everybody has an appointment with death. And what we try to do now in this school is to overcome death by him being formed in us, just as he conquered death, hell, and the grave. You see, you also too. You see, when he is formed in you, there is no more you that has existed. The more you learn about your creator, the more Joe dies, to the point that there is no more Joe. He just looked like Joe, and you call him Joe, but he's really Yahshua the Messiah. That's the reality of what we're talking about. Let's read, please.
Wherefore, Yahweh also hath highly exalted him.
Read.
And given him a name which is above every name.
Uh-huh.
That at the name of Yahshua, every knee should bow of the things in heaven and things in the earth and things under the earth, and that every tongue should confess that Yahshua Messiah is the Savior to the glory of Yahweh the Father.
That's good enough right there. So, A.C. Kelly is not your Savior. Buddha is not your Savior. Muhammad is not your Savior. And you, whoever you think you are not your own Savior. The only Savior that exists, because the only thing that exists, that is Yahshua Messiah. All right? Now, John 14. 14 and 1. Make it 6. Because eternal life is to know that thou, Father, art the true Elohim and Yahshua Messiah, whom thou sent. Because Yahweh is one spirit in two manifestations, incorporeal and corporeal. Let me nail this down before. Go back to 1 and 1 and hold that for me, please. Go John 1 and 1 quick. I mean, then I hit this again.
John 1 and 1.
Uh-huh.
In the beginning was the Word.
Now, in the beginning was the Word.
And the Word was with Yahweh.
The Word was with Yahweh.
And the Word was Yahweh.
And the shape and form was Yahweh. You see, it wasn't him or somebody else. It was Yahweh. Read on.
The same was in the beginning with Yahweh.
This same was in the beginning with Yahweh. That's what this heart is representing. Let's read. This all is the man. Read.
All things were made by him.
It didn't say some things were made by him. All things was made by the shape and form, or Yahweh Elohim, or Yahweh functioning as him in his I will be state. Let's read, please.
And without him was not anything made.
Without Yahweh himself coming from behind the veil of inscrutability and incomprehensibility.
That's right.
You see, all that you see would not be existent, because it was him who transmuted into the first, second, third, fourth, fifth, and the sixth day. Right. That's what he did. You see, and it was him through Adam, whereby all mankind, I'll say it like this, Adam is considered the father of all living, and Eve is considered the mother of all living. Abraham is considered the father of many nations, and his wife, Sarah, is considered the mother of many nations. But it was Yahweh, Elohim, who took up residence in that body, and we were all encountered in that body, and we lived in Adam before we died in Adam, because we are all encountered in that book of life. Whatever your name is, and your slave name, and your nickname, I'm letting you know, it's in the book of life.
Right.
All right? Read, please.
In him was life,
uh-huh.
And the life was the light of men.
So in him was life, and the life was the light of man. And in that, it was this spirit that illuminated Adam's consciousness and yours. Let's read.
And the light shineth in darkness.
Read.
And the darkness comprehended it.
Now the darkness is your corrupt soul. I'm not talking about no, I'm not saying you are criminal.
Right.
I don't want to use the word corrupt.
like you're a thief or something like that. That's not what I'm talking about.
Right.
What I'm saying, I use this example. When Easter comes, what that got to do with Easter? What that got to do with eggs and rats? That's what I'm talking about. You see, I don't get it. I don't know what that got to do with it. I don't get, you see, that when, let me come up with another one here. I just said that when Christmas comes, you see, where everybody go crazy? And what money got to do with that? It ain't got nothing to do with the Messiah, because he was born, you see, in the springtime,
right,
not the winter. Why are everybody praising and saying that it's his birthday? It's not his birthday. His birthday is June 6th. So we're corrupt in the head, you see, because it was taught us. And then you want to fight tooth and nails about it, all right? That's what I'm talking about, corrupt. So I'm saying we take on principles we want to fight about, like the name is Jesus. His name is not Jesus, his name is Yahshua. But people want to fight you and say, find some reason to justify it being Jesus and remain delusional.
That's true.
To have a delusion, the truth has to be established first. Without the truth being established, you cannot have a delusion. You're just ignorant. So if I tell you the truth, I'll give you an example. You looked at me funny.
Yeah, I know.
We're going to take this word lie. The common denominator in a lie is the truth. What Satan does, he perverts the truth and it becomes a lie. The truth always remains constant. So if I tell you that the name is Jesus all your life and that's all you know and that's all you believe, then that becomes a reality to you. And you are ignorant, and you've been deceived. True deception is being deceived and not knowing it, correct? That's true deception. So therefore, you see, once it's been introduced to you that Yahweh is the Father, you see, that Yah is masculine and Weh is feminine, and that Elohim is the title that Yahweh chose, because all Elohim means is the Almighty, you see, and then Yahshua is no more than Yahweh is salvation, because Shua means salvation. And you see the similarities of these names. Yah is masculine, his son is Yah is masculine, and when we are manifested, we come in our Father's name, and we show you that, but you still want to hold on and say, well, he knows who I'm talking about, right. Then you have a delusion. Mm-hmm. You see, because you choose to believe a lie. Right. And Yahweh will send you a strong delusion and cause you to believe a lie. That's what a delusion. Now, I didn't say an illusion. An illusion is a misconception of reality. You see, the sun does not move, correct? You see, but the earth spins on its axis, but it gives the appearance of a rising and a setting. You see, that's an illusion. An illusionist, I'm talking about a magician. What he does, he assaults a woman in heaven, make you think that he did it. Now you know, once you know the trick, how he did it, then you just took off the flesh. You see, because the reality, right. She was never cut in half. That's the point. So what he does, he just perverts the truth and then causes you to believe a lie. We good? All right. Now, let's read it down.
14. And the Word was made flesh. And dwelt among us.
Uh-huh.
And we beheld his glory, the glory of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth.
Okay, now jump down to 14 and 6. Now here comes the Messiah, we're talking about eternal life. All right, let's read.
Yahshua saith unto him,
read.
I am the way, the truth, and the life.
He says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. Let's read.
No man cometh unto the Father but by me.
Look, no man cometh up to the Father but by me. You see what I point? No man comes to the Father but me. Read, please.
If ye had known me, ye should have known my Father.
He said, now look, if you knew me, the shape and form, not the physical body. Alright, let's read.
Ye should have known my Father also.
If you knew me, do you know my Father? Because I have his attributal makeup. Let's read.
And from henceforth ye know him and have seen him.
Now look, you know him and I've seen him because I'm looking right at you. All right? But since you don't know me,
I'm Yahshua, I'm the son of Yahweh, then you don't have eternal life. One, I ain't put my spirit in you yet. I am fulfilling what was purposely declared back here in the realm of eternity. Let's read, please.
Philip saith unto him.
Now this is what Philip says unto the Messiah. Let's read.
Rabbi, show us the Father and suffice us.
Now he said, why don't you show us your daddy so it can satisfy our flesh.
Yeah.
All right? Let's read.
Yahshua saith unto him.
Now this is what he says.
Have I been so long time with you and ye hast thou not known me?
Now we talked about that earlier. In other words, know means two things. It means having a knowledge and having an intimate relationship with one, right? That way you know their heart, their mind, and their soul, if you will. All right? Let's read, please.
He has seen me, have seen the Father.
Look, he who have seen me, the shape and form, have seen the Father. Read, please.
And has said, then thou, show us the Father.
Read that again.
Okay. And has said, thou then, show us the Father.
And why are you talking about show us the Father if you haven't seen me? Because you got to see me first before you can see the Father. Because the Son who declares the Father, not the physical body. Let's read, please.
Believest thou not that I am in the Father and the Father in me?
He says, don't you believe that I'm in the Father? I'm in the Father and the Father's in me. My makeup is his attributal makeup, and this is my character and this is my nature. Let's read, please.
The words that I speak unto you, I speak not of myself, but the Father that dwelleth in me.
I'm talking about what I purpose and what I declare back here in the realm of eternity. That's all I can do. In other words, it is Yahweh in shape and form who is the mind of Yahshua Messiah. And the only thing that he's doing, talking about Yahshua Messiah, is carrying out the will of the Father, and that was purpose back in the realm of eternity. Nothing's happening by coincidence. Isaiah 46:9-10, please. Quickly, please.
Okay. Isaiah 46:9-10.
Yeah, you got to see this, folks. I just walk over here and get this thing here. There is a purpose. There is a pattern. And there is a plan. We call it the three P's. Alright? There's a purpose and a pattern and a plan existence. Yahweh's not doing anything by coincidence. Now Christianity, they think that when Adam was in the garden, Yahweh didn't know what was going to happen. Yahweh already knew that Adam was going to partake of the fruit, but they think that he could not keep the fruit. He disobeyed, he took the fruit, and Yahweh don't know nothing about it. Right. Yahweh set him up and declared that he would do that. It's not a coincidence. Let's read. This is what I'm talking about. Let's read, please.
Isaiah 46:9-10.
Go ahead.
Remember the former things of old.
Uh-huh.
For I am El, and there is none else.
For I am Elohim, and there is none else. I am the sun, the moon, the stars, and all things therein, including you. Read.
I am Elohim, and there is none like me.
I'm Elohim, and there is none like me. Now, folks get mad at me about this, but I really don't care. There is no such thing as a you and a Yahweh.
Right.
Never has, never will be. Why? Because Yahweh's all in all. And if he's all in all, that means he's the sum total of the universe, and all things proceed and come forth from him. He's the source and source. He's the source and substance of everything you see. We talked about it earlier. Yahweh means he who causes to exist. If it exists, it exists by the will of Yahweh, including you. So therefore, he's all in all. Let's read.
Declaring the end from the beginning.
He declared the end right from the beginning. Let's read.
And from ancient times, the things that are not yet
done. In other words, he's not a Yahweh of emergency. You know how we are. We have an accident, now we start calling on God. You see, but before that, we didn't give a damn about God. You get the point? Let's read.
My counsel shall stand, and I will do all
my pleasure. In other words, what I purpose in the realm of eternity, when I set it in motion, or when I set my purpose in motion, guess what? It's going to come to pass exactly the way I declared it. In other words, Yahweh purposed within himself, in his cloud, the creation didn't become this. Yahweh was already that. Here, it just made manifest.
Right.
He didn't just create this. He was already that, but it's being made known to Moses. You see, remember this. This is darkness right here. This is chaos right here. And we talked about this. We did talk about this the other night about chaos, right? How the, oh, did we get to that yet? Oh, it's coming up on. Maybe I hit it in a few minutes. This is chaos, and it's showing how Yahweh is behind the veil of inscrutability. But we have this party here to show that all the mystery and the deep esoteric secrets is hid in the midst of the cloud, or in the midst of Yahweh himself, who is pure spirit. But we got it parted so you can see. But in reality, the veils are down. You can't see what's behind the veil, just like you have a brain. Nobody can see inside your brain. And if I open you up, you still can't see. But we got it parted to let you know it is spirit law that's operating. You see, and then as Yahweh, you see, making his descent, you see, he got the creation surrounded, you see, in darkness, that ethereal darkness. And it is him who is moving on the face of the deep as the light shining in darkness, and the darkness comprehended it not. And as he's coming down, you see, making his descent, you see, there's veils, that darkness is that veil, and him moving on the face of the deep. And then he brings in, you see, the inorganic, you follow me? Substance. I'm talking about the elements and all that stuff. It begins to take on form like steam, you see, and those kind of things. And those molecules begin to come together. I'm talking about the atoms. And that's him manifesting the unfinished creation at that particular time. That's why this is called chaos. You don't see no diamonds, no trees, no mountains, no bicycles, no computers right there, but they're there. You see, and that's what this is depicting here. And it's Yahweh himself who is manifesting that darkness. And what you got to understand, the creation as you see it, this is his secret chamber. Let me say it like this. This is his secret chamber in the most holy place. And what you see here, this is his playground or his pavilion.
Okay.
All right? Yahweh is manifesting in the flesh, you see, functioning in his pavilion that he purposed and declared back here in the realm of eternity, if you will. Let's read, please.
Calling the eagle from the east.
Read.
The man that executed my counsel from a far country.
Read.
Yea, I have spoken it.
Read.
I will also bring it to pass.
Read on.
I have purposed it.
Uh-huh.
I will also do it.
So Yahweh purposed the purpose right back within himself, back here. And all he's doing is carrying out his purpose, and that is through the man. Everything has to be carried out through the man. All right? Now, get back to eternal life. Everything we're talking about today is eternal life. Now, we're going to turn our attention over to that garden over there. All right? Now, let's pick up real quick Exodus 24th chapter. I need somebody to have 126 ready. Where are you for me? This is when Moses talking about eternal life. We're going back to the source. All right? Showing you your origin, your beginning, your start place. And showing you how the Yahweh Elohim himself, he is eternal life. And how the Yahweh set up the first Adam, brought the purpose down, you see, and then brought in the second Adam to redeem the first Adam. But you got to know that thou art the true Elohim and Yahshua Messiah whom thou hast sent. That's what eternal life is. Let's read.
You want Exodus 24...
9 and 10.
Yes,
please.
Then went up Moses and Aaron, Nadab and Abihu, and 70 of the elders of Israel.
Here we go, read.
And they saw the Elohim of Israel, and there was under his feet, as it were, a paved work of a sapphire.
So they see the shape and form, talking about these 70 elders, and Aaron, Nadab, and Abihu, and Moses. Now let's get this straight. There was nothing righteous in these folks. The question is, what is righteous? Righteousness is without guilt, without fault. That's all it means. There is none righteous save him, save the Son. Everybody else is so-called, is just unrighteous. They don't know. We corrupt. But him, he knew what he was doing and why he was doing, and he executed what he purposed and declared back here in the realm of eternity, to the point that he was obedient to death willingly. Read, please.
And it were the body of heaven in his clearness.
So, as you said before, read on, please.
And upon the noble of the children of Israel, he laid not his hand.
Read.
Also, they saw Elohim and did eat and drink.
Now, these 74 people, they saw Elohim. But what they really saw was a reflection of themselves. They saw their attributal makeup in him. But they did not understand what it is that they saw. Okay? Because it was this shape, and form, then transformed into this tabernacle, having a most holy place, and a court round about. This is the pattern. But this shape and form is the true original pattern and is the true original temple. All right? Let's read, please.
And Yahweh said unto Moses, Come up to me into the mount and be there.
Read.
And I will give thee table of stone
read.
And a law and commandments which I have written that thou may teachest them.
Go ahead.
And Moses rose up and his minister Joshua.
Now here comes Joshua, who is Yahweh's body. Let's read.
And Moses went up into the mount of Elohim.
Go ahead.
And he said unto the elders,
read.
Tarry ye here for us.
Y'all stay down here, read. Now listen, when Moses get up here, Yahweh blacks him out. Very similar to when you go to bed at night. You're not conscious of your earthly realm. You don't feel your body. You don't feel anything physical. However, you're in that state where, how can I say it? As the founder said, it is that darkness is too dense. Do you follow me? To be earthly, too heavenly, and too light to be heavenly. Too dense to be heavenly and too light to be earthly. You see, that ethereal, that eternity, you see, that state that she's in. Read, please.
Tarry ye here for us until we come again
read.
Unto you.
Mm-hmm.
And behold, Aaron and Hur are with you.
Read.
If any man have any matters to do, let him come unto them.
So when he blacks him out, you see, he sees Elohim, he sees the tabernacle, and then he sees the creation come in by a pattern. He sees the man, how the man is formed from the dust of the earth. Talking about the finer particles of the earth. And when the man come in, he come in hermaphroditic, being both male and female. Why? Because Yahweh is both masculine and feminine within himself. He ain't got to go outside of himself to create or to procreate. And it was him who gave birth to his son, Yahweh Elohim. Who is also both master and figure within himself. Just as Yahweh gave birth to his son, Yahweh Elohim gave birth to Virgin Mother Earth. So therefore, when Adam formed from the dust of the earth, because the dust is the type of spirit, then Adam in turn had to give birth to Eve. He draws a woman out, and we call the creation Virgin Mother Earth. So guess what? We put out a woman here.
Right.
All right? Let's read, please.
And the glory of Yahweh abode upon Mount Sinai, and the cloud covered it 6 days.
Now this is the glory of Yahweh. Not the cloud, but the shape and form.
Mm-hmm.
All right? Now, head over to 126. And when he gets over here, since we've got some new ones here, let me just draw this out real quick before I nail this down here. 126. Go back, read over to where it says 24 and 16. I want folks to understand this. So we got some new ones here. My sister. Those are my sisters over here. Jeanette and Cheryl, they knew the class. And Gregory, I apologize, Gregory. He comes on Tuesday nights and Thursday nights. I'm shocked that he's here on a Sunday. It ain't Saturday. I thought he'd be in church and place. But anyway.
I was yesterday.
Oh, okay. I thought so. That's all right. We hold on to Yahweh's show. Read me.
You want Exodus?
I want Exodus 1, where we're talking about the 7 days. So it started at 16. The question is this. How is Moses, who wrote the Genesis, is able to write the Genesis when he didn't show up till 2,513 years, you see, after the creation come in? And he came in after Adam and not before Adam, yet he's writing about the Genesis. How do you do that? Moses is having a vision. We just told you he's having a vision. And he's seeing how the creation is coming in 6 days. And then Yahweh enter his rest. Let's read.
Genesis 1 and 16, you said now?
24:16. Genesis 1:1,
right.
But Exodus 24:16.
Right.
Because we're talking about Moses, and we're talking about how he brought the creation in. All right?
Okay, I'll do Exodus 24:16.
Yes.
And the glory of Yahweh abode Mount Sinai, and the cloud covered it 6 days, colon.
Now the colon means this. Whenever you see a colon, there should be some kind of explanation about those 6 days. You follow me? After that colon, correct?
Right.
Read. And the seventh day.
He called unto Moses.
But it said nothing about the 6 days.
No.
The only place you're going to read about 6 days, that's in Genesis. Now go ahead and read that just like it's supposed to be. read Exodus and then skip the Genesis right in there. Because the only thing you're going to read about 6 days is in the beginning of Genesis 1 and 1.
And the glory of Yahweh abode Mount Sinai, and the cloud covered it 6 days.
Now Moses is going to describe what happened in that mountain, because they asked him, "Why? What you were looking for 40 days and 40 nights, what happened to you?" And he said, "Well, in the beginning of my vision," read please.
"In the beginning, Elohim created the heavens
and earth." So he's describing what he saw. In the beginning of my vision, Elohim did what?
Created the heavens and earth.
He created the heavens and earth as you see it. Let's read.
"And the earth became without form and void."
And the earth as he knew it became without form and void. Just like when you go to sleeping out at night, the earth becomes without form and void. Isn't that right? Let's read, please.
"And the darkness was upon the face
of the..." And the darkness is upon the deep while you yet in your deep sleep. It's so dark you can't even describe it.
That's right.
Read, please.
"And the spirit of Elohim moved upon the face of the water."
And the spirit of Elohim moved on the face of the water, just like when you were in that state. Come on, when you sleep at night, your heart is still beating. The spirit of Elohim is moving on the face of the water, circulating through your blood. You follow me? Let's read, please.
"And Elohim said, let there be light."
Read.
"And there was light."
Read.
"And Elohim saw the light that it was good, and Elohim divided the light between the darkness."
That's good enough right there. So he just gonna walk out and bring that creation in. Now when you say let there be light in you, guess what? You begin to start dreaming. On the other side of creation, there's light. When you dream, you see light. You see everybody in the room, but you don't see you. But you're conscious of your essence. Mm-hmm. I'm talking about your attributal makeup. You see, your intelligence, your wisdom, your knowledge, your beauty, your love, justice, foundation, power, strength, your joy, your hope, all of that. There's nothing physical in a dream. That's why when we jump or we fall, we feel a sensation of falling, but we don't feel pain while we're in that state. All right? Now, Genesis 1:26.
"And Elohim said, let us make man in our image."
Uh-huh.
"After our likeness."
Read.
"And let them rule over the fish of the sea."
Read.
"And over the birds of the heavens."
In other words, the man was given dominion.
Mm-hmm.
He's the king. Because the king of kings is now taking a residence in that body. Let's read.
"And over the cattle, and over all earth, and over every creeping thing that creepeth upon the earth."
In other words, we ride elephants, we ride camels, we train dogs, love dogs,
mm-hmm.
pets. Y'all like pets?
Mm-hmm.
Y'all, as long as you got a dog, I got a dog.
Really?
I don't like nothing, I got to clean up behind it. I don't like cleaning behind my own self. But the point is, as long as you got a dog, I got a dog. You see, I love dogs as long as they're yours. You see, I appreciate them, I pet them, hug them. I might bring them some dog chow. But he can't come home with me, that's all. You get my point? But the point is, you get the point I'm trying to make here. Let's read, please.
"So Elohim created man in his image. In the image of Elohim created he him."
Uh-huh.
"Male and female created he them."
Now Moses is writing this, you see, but it was Joshua the son of Nun who went up with him, who's narrating Genesis to him. And he says, "Male and female created he him." You see, and it's some place in the way it said, "and called their name Adam." Let's read.
"And Elohim blessed them, and Elohim said unto him, be fruitful and multiply."
In other words, he has to be prolific. That means being fruitful. Just as Elohim was fruitful, Adam at some point in time, he had to be fruitful. Now let's get this straight. There was no sex in the garden.
Mm-hmm.
I'm being blunt right now. There was just absolutely no copulation, no intimacy, no heavy petting in the garden.
Right.
All right? Why? Because angels don't propagate. They just don't. Let's read.
"Be fruitful and multiply and replenish the earth."
Read.
"And subdue it. And rule over the fish of the sea and over the birds of the heaven."
Now, at that particular time, Eve was still in couch with Adam.
Mm-hmm.
All right? Read.
"And over birds of the heavens and over every creeping thing."
Read.
"That moves upon the earth."
Come on.
"And Elohim said, behold, have I given you every herb-bearing seed?"
Read.
"Which is upon the face of all the earth."
That's good enough right there. Go over to 2 and 4.
"And Yahweh Elohim formed..."
Let me have place 11 and 12. I appreciate that. Thank you so much. Now he formed Adam outside the garden.
All right? And the book said the man became a living soul. And then he was placed in the garden. Just like you should take on shape and form in your mother's womb, outside of the earth, and you come down, passing through the loins of your mother, you take up residence, the breath of life, or that spirit just steps right in you, then you become a living soul. In other words, and then you're placed in the airplane. You follow what I'm saying? You begin to move on around. You see? So Adam's form outside the garden, he became a living soul, and he placed in the garden. But Eve was drawn out in the garden. All right? And she too became a living soul. You won't read that, but she did. Read, please.
And Elohim formed the man of the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life. And the man became...
Does spirit breathe? Does the air breathe?
No.
He just stepped into the man. Moses to describe is something for you to understand.
Right.
You ask people, what is the soul? They say the breath of life. Okay, what is that? It is your attributal makeup. It's the essence which animates that body. All right? Let's read, please.
The breath of life. And the man became a living soul.
Read. It didn't say he became a living man. It says he became a living soul. Read.
And Yahweh Elohim planted a garden eastward in Eden.
Read on.
And there he put the man whom he had formed. And out of the ground made Yahweh Elohim to grow every tree that is pleasant to the sight.
Go ahead.
And good for food.
Read.
The tree of life.
Okay.
In the midst of the garden. And the tree of knowledge of good and evil.
Read.
And the river went out of
Eden. Jump down to 13.
Okay, 13. And Yahweh Elohim commanded the man, saying, of every tree of the garden thou mayest eat freely.
Read.
But the tree of knowledge of good and evil thou shalt not eat of it, for in the day that thou eatest thereof, thou shalt die the death.
Let's get this understood. There's no such thing as a tree of knowledge, a tree of good and evil.
Yeah.
It wasn't about the tree. It was about obedience versus being disobedient. And Yahweh obviously wanted him to partake of the tree because he pointed the tree out.
Right.
All right? The same thing your mom said. At least stay from, don't go to that girl's house. But you still looking. You follow what I'm saying? Let's read, please.
And Yahweh Elohim said,
read.
It is not good for the man to be alone.
Read.
I will make a help suitable for him.
A help meet or a woman is suitable, because he could not get with the orangutans, the lion, the bear, and the sheep, and the giraffe. He had to put Adam in a deep sleep. He put him in a deep sleep, which is likened unto death. And he draws the woman out. That's what this cameo is all about, because she is in him. Her being in him is like her being clothed in the sun, or she's encouched in the law, or spirit law. But when now she comes out, now she's subject to vanity. Mm-hmm. She's subject to vanity, and she's subject to the earthly realm. You see, that's how she became corrupt. So he presented her, you see, Adam, his bride, or he presented her to her husband. You see, and that is what we call the division of the sexes. And as the founder said, they were in love, you see, and it was in harmony, and it was in unity, you see. However, there's this little boy, this little angel way back here, who was spying them out, you see, spying out, you see, the father's nakedness. And he's checking them out. Now, he could have, talking about Lucifer, he could have went to Adam, you see, and confronted him. But he looks almost like the one who cast him out of heaven. So what he does, he goes to watch the woman, and he begins to deceive her. Real quickly, pick up Genesis 8. Is it 10 and 8? I think it's 10 and 8. 8 and 10. It might be 8 and 10. Talks about Nimrod. Mm-hmm.
8 and 10?
I think that's where it's not 8 and 10, it's 10 and 8.
It's 10 and 8.
It's 10 and 8? Okay, 10 and 8.
10 and 8. And Cush begot Nimrod.
Cush begot Nimrod.
He began to be a mighty one
In
the earth. He was a mighty hunter, posing Yahweh.
Now Nimrod built the Tower of Babel.
Mm-hmm.
All right? Now, Nimrod was 6 generations from Cain. All right? The number 6 is symbolic of 666, or the satanic spirit. Now, and that Nimrod's a mighty hunter, Lucifer, he has the attributal makeup of Lucifer. In other words, he perverts what Yahweh set up. He says don't do it, he says do it. Mm-hmm.
If Yahweh say do it, he said don't do it. All right, let's read.
He was a mighty hunter opposing Yahweh.
Read.
Therefore, it is said, even as Nimrod, the mighty hunter opposing Yahweh, and the beginning of his kingdom was Baal.
My point is, what the hunter does, he spies out. He lies in wait, and he's checking out. He's checking her out. It's like the neighbor. You going to work, or school, whatever, and your woman out there watering yard, my own doggone business. But the neighbor says, hey girl, how you doing? How you doing, neighbor? And she's just being neighborly and say, how you doing? But only out there when she's up. You get the point I'm trying to make? Spying her out. Read, please.
And the beginning of the kingdom was Babel and Erech. And
that's enough right there. Okay. I just want to make that comment. Okay. Now jump down to three. Three and one.
Yes. Now the serpent was more subtle than any beast of the field.
Read.
Which Yahweh Elohim had made.
Read on.
And he said unto the woman, have Elohim said, ye shall not eat of every tree of the garden?
Now here she is spying out the tree. Mm-hmm. And he shows up and tells her, have a conversation with her. Listen, girl, Elohim said, don't eat the tree, but you go ahead and eat it, because if you do eat it, guess what? Ain't nothing going to happen. Read, please.
And the woman said unto the serpent,
read.
We may eat of the fruit of the tree of the garden, but the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, Elohim has said, ye shall not eat of it, neither shall ye touch it.
Read.
Lest ye die.
Read on.
And the serpent said unto the woman, no death will you die.
Now, this is delusion. We got a serpent drawn painted here. But this is a man that we're dealing with. We're talking about characteristics. We talk about a man who presents well, but he have a different agenda. And in this particular case, Lucifer presents to her and give her the impression that if she be disobedient, you see, that will be okay and she won't die. She have no clue what death is. There's none of us on the earth plane know what death is when we're born. We grow up, we see death, we just run around and play, throw rocks. You get the point? Because you don't know what's going on. You just assume they sleep like everybody else.
Yeah.
We don't know that death, you see? So she didn't know what death was. Adam didn't know what death was at that particular time. Let's read.
For Elohim doth know that in the day ye eat thereof,
read,
your eyes shall be open.
Now he says, when you partake of this fruit right here, your eyes of understanding will be open. You know how somebody tell you a lie, all of a sudden you find out the truth, now your eyes are open. You see the reality. You feel like you've been deceived. He says, one thing when somebody's cheating, I just use that as an example. That's not what bothers you to act. It's the deception that kills you the most.
Right.
You going to work, doing this, doing that, and she's lying or he's lying for the last 4 or 5 years, you follow what I'm saying? And next thing you know, you find out this been going on. It wasn't the act that hurt you, it's the deception. You
right.
feel like an idiot, like a doggone fool. You get the point I'm trying to make? Read, please.
And ye shall be as Elohim, knowing good and evil.
In other words, she told her she will be as Elohim, knowing good and evil. She already was Elohim. It was part of her makeup. He tricked her and made her think she's going to become something she already was. Let's read.
And when the woman saw that the tree was good for food.
So when she looked at it, read on.
And the tree was good for food.
It appealed to her.
Mm-hmm. And that it was pleasant to the eyes.
She wanted it.
And a tree to desire to make one wise.
Read.
She took of the fruit thereof and did eat and gave it unto her husband with her. And he did eat.
Because he loved her so much, he had to eat. But he had to also take responsibility for her. He partook of the fruit, and the book says their eyes were open. Read that.
And the eyes of them both were open.
Read.
And they knew that they were naked.
Now they knew they were exposed. Folks always think physically. You get caught in a lie, you're exposed.
Right.
That's the reality of it. So she got exposed. He got exposed. He was told not to eat. He ate, but he had a conversation with Yahweh because he's the mediator. You see, and he's kind of like having a conversation with Yahweh. Yahweh in turn telling him what to do, and he in turn tells Eve what to do. He told her what to eat, what to not to eat, just like you tell your kid what to eat, what not to eat, when to go to bed. Not. That's what he's doing to her. That's his offspring, and he dictating to her just like you dictate to your offspring. Let's read.
And the eyes of them were both were open.
Read.
They knew that they were naked.
They knew they were exposed. Read.
And they sewed fig leaves together.
She ate the fruit. He ate the fruit. It was told not to. Now they are condemned. Let's read.
and made themselves aprons.
Read.
And they heard the voice of Yahweh Elohim as they were walking in the garden in the cool of the day.
Read.
And the man and his wife hid themselves from the presence of Yahweh.
Read.
Elohim. Amongst the trees in the garden.
Go ahead.
And Yahweh Elohim called unto the man and said unto him, Where art thou?
Now he's talked to Adam within his consciousness. Let's read.
And he said, I have heard thy voice in the garden.
Read.
And I was afraid because I was naked.
Read.
And hid myself. And he said, Who told thee that thou was naked?
Hold it. He was trying to figure out what lie he gonna tell. You have to be home at 8 o'clock. And you showing up at 8:30. On the way, you got to figure out something to try to justify what it is, why you get home at 8:30, and you might have parked up the street trying to figure out a lie to deceive yourself to explain it to your parents. You get the point I'm trying to make? Read, please.
And he said, Who told thee that thou was naked?
So he said, Who told you you was naked?
Hast thou eaten of the tree?
Read.
Whereof I commanded thee that thou shouldest not eat.
Come on.
And the man said, The woman that thou gavest to
me. He points the finger at her. Let's read the woman.
She gave me of the tree.
Read.
And I did eat.
Uh-huh.
And Yahweh Elohim said unto the woman.
Now he turned the attention from the woman. Now he turns to the serpent. Let's read.
What is this that thou hast done?
Read.
And the woman said, The serpent beguiled me, and I did eat.
In other words, he tricked me and made me think it was okay. So I ate it and I gave it to him.
Mm-hmm.
You see? Let's read.
And Yahweh Elohim said unto the serpent.
Now he goes to the serpent for messing with my bride. Read on.
Because thou hast done this.
Uh-huh.
Thou art cursed above all cattle.
Read.
And every creeping beast of the field. And upon thy belly shalt thou go, and thus shalt thou eat all the days of thy life.
Now this is deception. We see this snake on the ground. We actually think it's a real snake. But we're talking about the characteristics of Lucifer, who is a snake. You see, he's cunning. You see, he's deceiving, and he makes you think everything is all right, but what he's doing, he's setting you up for the kill.
Mm-hmm.
You follow me? And that's exactly what he did. That's exactly what we all do at some point in our life. We give the impression everything is all right, it's going to be like this or like that, but in reality, we have a different agenda.
Mm-hmm.
You see, that's what's happening here. You see, so he cursed the ground. Let's read.
And I will put enmity between thee.
Open hatred. Let's read.
And the woman.
Read.
And between thy seed and her seed.
Read.
He shall bruise thy head, and thou shalt bruise his heel.
That's good enough right there. The point is, they were now condemned, so they have now come down out of that garden. And that's what you see that black ball represents. Darkness. From the fall of Adam, all the way down to Yahshua the Messiah. You see, and when Yahshua the Messiah shows up in the likeness of sinful flesh, his mission and his goal was to redeem Adam. You see, to take that curse off him. You see, place the woman back in him, and then him, you see, resurrecting a quickened spirit and ascending to the Father. So therefore, what you see here as the woman now, after his death, his burial, his resurrection, ascension, and outpouring of the Holy Spirit, whereby grace has been dispensed. You see, now, first, the Jews received the Holy Spirit, you see, or grace, if you will, and then 7 years later, here come the Gentiles. But the woman is now clothed with the sun or in the sun. And this moon or this law which governs them is now under her feet. And this law no longer have dominion over them. So when you try to perform that law and think you're going to have salvation, what you're doing, you're dragging those principles off on over here. Because he was cut off at the cross. In that now, the veil has been lifted and we can see what's really happening because the mystery has been locked, unlocked in this age. Now we know for surety that we are who we've been looking for. We are Yahweh in the body and the person. We are Yahweh in the personality of whoever we are, whatever your name is, carrying out the will of the Father. And Yahweh has allowed you to fall just like he allowed Adam to fall.
Right.
And in that Adam fell, you see, he was condemned. And listen, he's in a fallen state. And when Yahweh finally communicate with you, you're going to find yourself too in a fallen state. But when you become conscious of Yahshua Messiah in you, and you become conscious of your attributal makeup, you find out that these are not your attributes, but it's Yahweh's attributes functioning as you. You are Yahweh in the personality of LeBron, carrying out the will of the Father. The problem is that you think that you're somebody other than who you really are.
Right.
But the reality is, right, there's never been a you to be you.
That's right.
It's always been him functioning as you. Mm-hmm. And what you have to do is to die. You see, mm-hmm, and when you die, that means now you become knowledgeable of your creator as he really is and as he exists. And as he is formed in you, then you become him and you function in his kingdom and you reign as the son of Yahweh, but your true name is Yahshua Messiah, because Job no longer did exist. That corruption, or that corrupt heart and mind and soul, has now put on incorruption. You see, that mortality has put on immortality. Those theories, concepts, and opinion have been abolished because the proof has been presented to me, the precepts have been presented to me, and the truth has been yet been manifest. Now I can reign and have eternal life. That's why the last aim said to inherit eternal life now in the kingdom of Yahshua Messiah with the hope of immortal glorification. What do you mean immortal glorification? You've taken off the flesh and you put on that immortal body that will reign with Yahshua forever. Mm-hmm. I hope and trust you guys got something I would say. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Okay, thanks for that. Our next speaker will be Dr. LeBron Horton. It's good to see you too, Emily too.
Good afternoon, class.
Yeah, good afternoon.
Can you pass me my glasses, man?
Yes, sir.
I appreciate it. I can't see. Thank you so much.
So, our dean was supposed to finish that out. That was good. As soon as he was done, Emily was like, they're about to call you. I have truly missed class. Our heart and mind has been with you guys. Sometimes we'll watch it on Facebook. But I've been in school. And, but it's always good to be here learning about the divine purpose, pattern, and plan of Yahweh. If I can get, I believe it's First Timothy 5:21, or 2 Timothy 5:21. Prove all things and hold fast to that which is good. So if we have some new people here, I want to say, I'm sure. No, not that new. Okay. I'm sure you know your brother, and you know that he understands Yahweh's divine purpose, pattern, and plan, and he labors day and night to make sure that this class is fed with the knowledge of Yahweh, Elohim, and Yahshua, and that's what it's all about. So I want to start off with this scripture. If you could read that, please.
1 Thessalonians 5:21.
Mm-hmm.
Prove all things.
Okay.
Hold fast that which is good.
Now, before I came in here, I never heard that scripture.
Me either.
And it surprised me that it was in there, because whenever you question your pastor, you know, when I was growing up, it doesn't happen a lot now, but when I was growing up, whenever you question your pastor about something, he would just say, well, just shut up, boy, and stay out of God's business. And he would want to just get up here and tell you what he wanted to tell you. And you just had to accept it. So when any speaker gets up here and they lay down this divine purpose, pattern, and plan that was given to our founder, Dr. Henry Kiffer Kinley, we need to prove it. Why? Because there are all kinds of gospels out there and preachings out there that say, for one thing or another, that we have the truth. So who to believe? Do you believe the Vedas? Do you believe the Muslims? Do you believe the over 3,000 different denominations of Christianity? Right? Do you believe one speaker over another in this class?
Mm-hmm.
Right? But the scripture says, read it again.
Prove all things.
Prove some things.
All things.
Prove most things.
All things.
Right? Prove the things that you can only prove.
All
no,
things.
You prove all things. See? And so what we have down here is this tabernacle pattern. If I can go back to Exodus, I think it's 24:8-9 or 9-10. Mm-hmm. And also on Hebrews, the 8th chapter, I believe the 5th verse. So our founder just, he laid it down. I mean, it's going to be hard to follow. So I'm just going to go back over some of the fundamental things. Because what I love, when I grew up, I had dyslexia. I have dyslexia, still have it. I have ADHD. And when I was in school, they put me in special ed. So because back then they didn't understand those. Now people are starting to say dyslexia is an advantage, but it gives, because it gives you, you find different ways of seeing the truth. But back when I was in high school, they was like, oh, you're just stupid. We're going to put you with stupid kids. Right? You were retarded. Now, we don't use that word no more, right? But that's what it was. But one thing that was a blessing for me is, you just got to make it plain for me. Lay it down and make it simple. And it needs to be something where I don't want to learn a lesson from every single little subject matter in the world. Give me a principle that I can see, and let me see that principle being played out in everything. That's the way it works for me. Because if I have to sit here and learn psychology and learn all the things that has to do, and then learn math and all the things that pertain to math, and then learn my job, and then learn my kids, I'm not smart enough to do that. My brain doesn't function that way. But we have this divine purpose, pattern, and plan that Yahweh's laid out, and his pattern that we can see operating throughout eternity. And that's why this class is surrounded by Bible stories. Because we're going to show you how this pattern plays out in everything. So that's why it says, prove all things. And then after you prove all things, and I know I have those other scriptures waiting, what do you do when you prove all things? Go back to that.
Hold fast that which is
good. Hold fast to it. See, because our dean did a beautiful job in teaching you. This is not a snake. This isn't a man. Let me bring it home. What he said, and this man resides within us.
Right.
The ignorance. He's speaking to us. So when you prove something, hold fast, because he's going to try to knock you off. Hold fast to it. Why? Because there's going to come a time when you're going to doubt. There's going to come a time when you're not so sure. There's going to come a time when everything is rocky. My dad used to always say, there's going to come a time when there's a storm surrounding you. And where do you want to be? Right in the eye, where it's calm. You want to stand still, and you want to be able to be stable. So once you've proven some things, you want to hold fast to it. Is there more to that? Hold fast to that which is good.
Right?
So you've proven it. You see it's good. Don't let go. So back to Exodus.
You say 24:9-10?
I believe that's it, yeah.
Then went up Moses and Aaron.
No, that's 25:8-9. Thank you.
Yes. And let them make me a sanctuary that I may dwell among them.
Now, this is after the children of Israel. If you've seen the movie The Ten Commandments, or if you've seen Egypt, the cartoon, Prince of Egypt, and you know the children of Israel were down here in bondage, and Yahweh led them up, and they were in Arabia on Mount Sinai, and they had to clean themselves up, and Yahweh had them here down here, right, on their way up to the Promised Land, and he told them, let them make me a sanctuary. Read.
That I may dwell among them.
That I may dwell among them, and who's speaking? That's Yahweh, right? Read.
Yahweh. According to all that I show thee, after the pattern of the tabernacle.
Now, I did a wonderful job saying that Moses was brought up here, and Yahweh Elohim showed him in a vision. Right? It wasn't the flesh. He didn't break out a PowerPoint presentation, right? He showed him in a vision all of the structure, the function, and how this pattern, how to build it, what it should be built out of, all the way down to the measurements, right? The material you use, everything of how this tabernacle pattern operates. And he showed him how he played that out through the whole universe from the beginning to the end. Read.
And the pattern of all the instruments thereof, even so shall ye make it.
Mm-hmm. Read.
And they shall make an ark of shittim wood, mm-hmm. 2 cubits and a half, right, the length thereof.
Now he's talking about this pattern. Now you say, well, that's irrelevant. That was back then, you know. What does that matter now? Hebrews.
Hebrews 8:5.
Mm-hmm.
Who serve unto the example and
now,
shadow.
Now, what he's talking about, Moses is talking about these children of Israel. And he says, these people, what they went through, served as a what?
Who served unto an example.
As an example for us, read.
And shadow of heavenly things.
And a shadow of heavenly things, right? Real quick, Romans 1:19-20.
Because that which may be known of Yahweh.
Now, he said that there's a shadow of heavenly things. Now, see, you can't see spirit, right? And our dean did a wonderful job explaining that there is, where is it pointed out here? Where when you see these hearts, I can't remember what chart he was pointing to, but when you see those hearts, we're showing you the veil has been torn away, and he's showing you the mystery of righteousness here. So when Yahweh Elohim shows somebody something in a vision, he's tearing away your misconcepts, your opinions, to show you the divine truth and, the, as he says, some of the all of the secrets of the universe, mm-hmm. right? So he's saying, now look, in order for you to understand some of those things, you need to be shown how the physical things work, because if you show how the physical things work, you'll understand how the spiritual things work, read.
For, because that which may be known of Yahweh is manifest in them.
Right.
For Yahweh has showed it unto them.
Showed it unto them, right?
For the invisible things of Him.
Now we're not talking about brazen labors anymore. See, these are principles, and that's what I love. See, a principle is something that applies in different situations on down the line. That's what my dyslexic butt needs. I need a principle that I can follow, or else I get messed up. So if I'm raising my kids and I'm trying to teach my kids something, I want to have the principle of having standards. I like to teach my family, this is how we do it here. If I'm starting a business, Apple says, we have standards. If we're playing football, now sometimes it gets messed up, what's a catch and what's not a catch, right? But there are standards. There are certain things that you need to do on a consistent basis, no matter what the circumstances are. Those are principles for me. I need to see that on down the line in my physical body. I need to see that in my history, in my Bible. I need to see that in how it plays out in my life. And that's the beauty of it. We're not talking about this physical building that was made. People are still looking for, right? Raising the lost ark. We're talking about principles, right? Of these attributes here that Yahweh laid out in a physical, actual building for your salvation. That's the beauty of it. I know I got a lot. So go back to Hebrews, please.
Who served unto the example and shadow of heavenly things.
Read.
As Moses was admonished.
Now Moses was admonished of Elohim to do what?
When he was about to make the tabernacle.
Mm-hmm.
For see saith he.
He says, for see saith he, read.
That thou make all things according to
now the pattern. Now thou make all some things according
all
to the pattern.
All things.
You just make this building right here according to the pattern. All things. That's what our dean gets excited about. You see, you don't have to follow a pastor. Now our dean gets up here and does a beautiful job, but he's saying, don't follow me and don't follow Dr. Kinley. He's trying to explain to you that Yahweh inside of you is a pattern.
Right.
Isn't that beautiful? You don't have to sit there and wonder, oh, what's God going to do next? How does he work? How does he think? Well, we got to go to this pastor, give him a whole lot of money so he can get on jets and fly across the world to preach the gospel, because I don't know what Yahweh's about. No. He's got a simple pattern right here, and he put it in you, and he put it through all of your Bible stories. And when you go and learn about science, you'll learn about atoms and cells. He put it everywhere. Read.
See, saith he, that thou make all things mm-hmm. according to the pattern shown to thee in the mount.
Mm-hmm.
But now he has obtained a more excellency
mm-hmm.
ministry. Read. By how much also he is a mediator between a...
Okay, that's good right there. So we have this divine tabernacle pattern, and it's broken up into three parts. It's broken up into the court roundabout, the holy place, and the most holy place. And it has nine divine
furnishings,
right? And we have down here, you have, now there's a veil or a door separating, or when you first start here with the gate. And then there's a door here that separates the court roundabout from the holy place. And there was a veil here, right, that separates from the holy place to the most holy place, right? And there's seven steps in this pattern. And the reason why our dean pointed out that how 666 or 6 is the mark of the beast, because this veil is the sixth step. And it is a veil that prevents you from seeing the glory of Yahweh, right? So what I love about it is when you read the Bible and you hear things about 666, what that's telling you is that the devil or Satan has a veil of the flesh, has a veil of the spirit, and has a veil of his mind, the carnal mind. So he's just all the way screwed. He can't see anything. See, but what happens is Yahweh has torn this veil so that you can see, and the veil is here. I'm pointing at
that's right,
here.
That's right.
He has torn this veil so you can see the glory of Yahweh. And what the high priest would do is he would function in this, right? And once a year, on the day of Pentecost, he would go into this operate or officiate in this pattern, and he would cleanse, he would officiate in here for the cleansing of the children of Israel that surrounded this, right? He would cleanse, he would do the cleansing for the tabernacle, and he would do cleansing for himself. And at the end of his function, and I'm not going to get into the detail now because we don't have a lot of time. At the end of this functioning, there would be a Shekinah here, or Shekinah as they call it, and that will reveal Yahweh Elohim on top of the mercy seat, right? So these are all the things that we're learning about. I'm running out of time. I just wanted to get into some of the basics here to kind of recap on what our dean was saying. These are some of the basic things that you can learn and you can hold for yourself, right? And what our dean, what our founder would say is, I had a vision. And he says, now make me prove it until you're satisfied. I love that. There's some things in here I'm not satisfied with. So I go to Yahweh and I say, Yahweh, show me how this works. I don't understand. You can be in here for 20 years and there's things that you still don't understand, but you can have a foundation that says, I can stand on this. So when I'm talking to somebody, I know what I'm talking about. And when I'm alone and by myself, and I'm struggling with life, I have this foundation to stand on. And that's what it's all about. You're not going to get into heaven on anybody else's coattails. See what I'm saying? You have to have an understanding and a divine understanding of Yahweh Elohim. And our founder talked about, it's about knowing who your divine father is, what's his name, how does he operate,
that's right,
how does he function,
yeah,
right? What is he saying and what he's not saying? What is he requiring of you and what is not requiring of you? And see, that's why we come down here. So what I want to say is, whether you're new or old, right, young or old, or you've been here for 40 years and you're just coming in here, you still want to keep learning. And also at the same time, you know, this is your rock. This is my rock when I'm here and when I'm not here. The gospel guides everything I do. It comforts me when I have really bad days, when I'm doubting myself. It comforts me when I know I need to be the head of my household and take care of my family, and I'm having challenges doing that. It also keeps me humble to say, if anything happens good, and there's times, and we're at this stage in our life now, where Yahweh just opens doors up to you. Now you have two choices. You can work with that carnal mind that says, oh, it's because I'm the big wig. The one that says, oh, I made this happen. I can pop my collar now. Or you can have an understanding that says, it's just Yahweh operating his mercy, his love,
very good,
right, in my life. But you don't have to do that in the sense of saying, well, let me just go give my pastor some money because he said this is going to happen. No, you understand Yahweh's divine attributes and you recognize them in your life. And that's what this is all about, is seeing this in you.
Very good.
Right?
Right?
And that's what Adeem talked about. He belabored the whole point, and he worked really hard to try to help you to understand that it's you don't exist. It's Yahweh Elohim in you is where there's glory. And then he corrected it and said, when that scripture said, have this mind, no. Have that spirit, because the mind is corruptible. And that's what we're down here for, to understand that we want to have that spirit in us, operating, making decisions, feeling like, okay, there could be chaos going on around us, but I'm all right. I'm cool. Haters at your job. That's my thing. How is he operating on a daily basis? Your daughter's tripping. She's going through puberty. Your boss is tripping. Right? Creditors is after you. Your car done broke down. You know what I'm saying? Boom. I have this divine pattern in my life. And that is Yahweh himself. I'm not talking about some really cool thing that you can use every, you know, like a get out of jail free card. I'm talking about Yahweh Elohim himself. And I know how he operates. And I know what he's looking for. And I know what he wants. Because he makes it clear. And when I'm doubting, I see it in my body. And when I'm doubting, I see it in the universe. And when I'm doubting, I see it in all the Bible stories that we read about. That's what it's all about. Seeing him in everything, in you and in everything. And seeing his divine purpose of the righteousness, of the mystery of righteousness, and the mystery of iniquity operating. When you see the mystery of iniquity operating, he's talking about he conquered, Yahweh conquered death. And you see the mystery of iniquity trying to get you to fear death of all kinds and get you to fear. And you look at him and say, I see what you're doing. That's joy in your heart. That's comfort. That's what you want. And that's what we come down here. And with that, I'll just say, keep coming back. If you're semi-new, if you're old, keep coming back. If you can't be here. What? It don't matter. If you're old, you're young, keep coming back. No, a lot of times, I'm talking about myself. Sometimes I've been like, man, I've been in this class since I was 16 years old. Sometimes you're like, I'm tired. And sometimes, I'm not going to lie, sometimes I'm like, I didn't hurt at all. But you know what Yahweh had in my heart is, I haven't had all the revelations. I'm not down here to hear it.
That was good.
I'm down here to get a revelation. So I'm talking to myself. If you're young, old, if you've been here for long, if you're not, keep coming back. If you can't come, that's why we got it on online. That's why Yahweh has got technology to where if you really can't make it, watch it. And be with it. Read the scriptures. Do the research yourself. And with that, I'll say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
In other words, if you're still breathing. Okay, that concludes today's lectures. There's going to be a convention in New Mexico, right?
Yeah, November 9th.
November 9th, so Joe would like to see full attendance there in the school, if you can, to represent our school there in New Mexico. Okay? Do we have the dates posted up there in the calendar?
Yes. Uh-huh.
So to take a look at the calendar and let you know. Also in Miami, and that was Miami?
Orlando.
Orlando, Florida, there's going to be a program too. So if you're interested, take a look at that, okay? Now we have classes here Sundays, 11 to 1, Tuesdays and Thursdays, Friday, Thursdays, 7:30, 9:30. All donations can be had by Dr. Eunice Reiser. It's all staff be dismissed. And we also have a Spanish class every fourth Sunday of the month at 9:30, 10:45. Now unto him that is able to keep you from falling and present you faultless with his presence with exceeding joy. So arise out of our Savior to Yahshua the Messiah, sovereign, belong glory, majesty, dominion, and power, both for all time, now and ever. Let's all say,
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
She knows everything and can teach you too.
Well, let's just copy that. This is the ideal stuff. I don't seal the download.
I call it. Is it a square button? I don't want to tell.